Welcome to the Physics Classroom's video tutorial on static electricity. The topic of this video is polarization, and here's the questions we're going to answer. What is polarization, and how does polarization occur for conductors and for insulators? And finally, how does polarization explain the interaction that occurs between charged and neutral objects? Well, I'm Mr. H. Let's get started. In a previous video of this tutorial series, this one, we discussed charge interactions. If you need to review, you'll find the link in the description section below. What we learned when we had this video is we learned that there are three types of charge interactions. The first is that objects with like charge, both positive or both negative, will repel one another. And objects that have the opposite types of charges will attract one another. And finally, any charged and neutral object will always attract one another. Of the three, the one that's most surprising is this last one, that charged and neutral objects attract. What's up with that? Well, let me show you what I'm talking about with the following demonstration. In this demonstration, we have a wooden board to represent a wall, neutral paper bits, and a balloon that's charged. We'll begin by bringing the wooden wall near the paper bits. There's no interaction, so we know that our wall is neutral. Now we'll charge the balloon by rubbing it on wool. We bring it near the paper bits, a clear interaction, which tells us the balloon is charged. Now when we bring it to the wall, it attracts the wall. A neutral wall and a charged balloon attract. We'll repeat this procedure using a different balloon. We'll charge it on wool, bring it near the paper bits, observe that the balloon is charged. Then, place the balloon next to the wall of the room, and we notice once more an attraction. But exactly why does a neutral object like the wall and a charged object like the balloon attract? What's going on at the particle level to allow for such an attraction? Matter consists of atoms, and atoms consist of positively charged protons and neutral neutrons located in a nucleus, which is surrounded by electrons that are negatively charged and thought of as existing in electron shells or clouds. Now, in conducting materials, these electrons are not actually owned by the atoms themselves. They're free to move about from atom to atom across the surface of that metal conductor, which means that as they move, they're motivated by the rule that opposites attract and likes repel, which tells us that these mobile electrons will be attracted to any nearby positive object and repelled by any nearby negative object. Let me demonstrate. This demonstration involves a metal pop can, a PVC tube, and some paper bits. I'm going to begin by bringing the pop can near the paper bits. There's no interaction, so this pop can is neutral. It's also a conductor, which means its electrons are free to move about its surface. Now I'm going to rub the PVC tube on some wool, then bring it near the paper bits, a clear interaction. Then watch as I do the following. What kind of sorcery is this? We can explain this demonstration through use of the concept of polarization. When I think of polarization, I think of certain social political discussions that have a habit of dividing the country into opposites, with those that are against it on one side of the fence and those that are for it on the opposite side of the fence. The same thing occurs electrically to a conductor like the pop can. Normally, the electrons are evenly distributed about the surface of the conducting pop can, but when a positively charged tube comes nearby, the electrons are drawn near that tube. That polarizes the pop can, with more positives on one side and more negatives on the other side. And the negative part of the pop can is now next to that positive tube. That makes for a great attraction, and the pop can begins rolling. The same thing occurs if a negative tube is brought near that pop can. The electrons see the negative tube and move away from it. That polarizes the can, with the centers of positive charge next to that negative tube. Once more, that makes for a great attraction and begins to roll the can along the table. So this pop can activity demonstrates the idea of polarization, that when a charged object's brought near that neutral pop can, electrons begin to migrate either towards a positively charged object or away from a negatively charged object. This leaves the pop can polarized, separated into opposites, with the positive side of the can always being closest to the negatively charged object, and the negative side of the can will always be closest to a positively charged object. The pop can demonstrates the polarization of conductors, where electrons can move from atom to atom across the surface. But that's not the case for insulators. So how does an insulator become polarized? Well, we need to think about the atom again. The center of positive charge in an atom is the nucleus, the only location where positive charge is. But for negative charge, that's the electrons that surround the nucleus. And on average, there's just as many electrons on one side of the nucleus as on the other side of the nucleus, which means that on average, the center of negative charge is also right in the nucleus. So the atom doesn't come polarized. But if you bring a negatively charged object near an atom, electrons within the atom will respond differently to that negatively charged object. They will say to themselves, well, I want to spend more time on the right side of the nucleus than on the left side of the nucleus, which causes a distortion of the electron clouds with more electron density located on the right side of that nucleus, thus polarizing the atom, separating it into opposites, into positives and negative sides. Well, the same thing happens if you have a positively charged object brought near an atom. What happens at this point is electrons say to themselves, oh, I want to be more on the left side of the nucleus than on the right side of the nucleus, which once more distorts the electron clouds and polarizes the atom, with negatives being closest to the positive object and positives being furthest away. Now, this is what happens to polarize an atom. And if you have an object composed of many atoms, what will happen to those atoms on the surface of that object is many of them will polarize, thus polarizing that object. So now we're back to the original demonstration of the balloon in the wall attracting one another, and to the question, why do charged and neutral objects attract? And our answer is, because likes repel, opposites attract, and neutral objects can become polarized. So when you charge a balloon up negatively and you bring it near a wall, the negative balloon repels the electrons in the atoms that are on the outside of the wall, distorting their electron clouds. The result is that the particles of the wall become polarized, with the center of positive charge being located nearest the balloon. And now what we have is the negative balloon and the positive part of the wall particles attracting each other. That's why neutral and charged objects attract one another. It's important to understand that the polarization process is not the charging process. There's no charging going on here. Charging involves the movement of electrons onto an object or off of an object so as to disrupt the balance of charge within that object. That's not what's going on with polarization. In polarization, electrons are moving, but they're moving within the object, never leaving it, never entering it, but only moving within its boundaries. We've been using the pop can as our example for polarization. Before the pop can gets polarized, it's a neutral object. There's no center of excess positive or excess negative charge. But when we bring a positively charged object near to it, we force electrons to move from the left side to the right side of the can. This gives rise to an excess of positive charge on the left side and negative charge on the right side. But it's overall neutral because electrons have not entered or left the pop can. Polarization is not the same as charging. It's at this time in every video that I'd like to help you out with an action plan, a series of next steps for making the learning stick. But before I help you out, maybe you could help us out. If you like the video, could you give us a like, subscribe to the channel, tap the bell and get notifications, or leave a question or comment in the comment section below. Now for your action plan. Here's three resources from our website. You'll find links to each one of them in the description section of this video. The first is a simulation that I've been using here in this video, the pop can simulation. The second is a concept builder, excellent practice. And the third is a tutorial from our website on the topic of polarization. Whatever you do, I wish you the best of luck. I'm Mr. H, and I thank you for watching.